At the beginning of the meeting, for the sake of the recording, all right? And then we'll actually get started. All right, so any of you guys that have another primary chapter and are changing to Black Desert as your primary chapter, I need you to let me or Dead Man know. All right, because we've got that thing called the Busy Bee Award for being in chapters, and you have to be in them a certain length of time and stuff like that before you're credited with it for that award. So please let me or Dead Man know if you're changing primary chapter to Black Desert, okay? All right. Newbies, do we have a newbie or two in here? I think we have at least one. One thing I want to remind you guys about is if you haven't gotten your post count up to the required amount for Worker Bee, which is 10, please do so as soon as possible. You are absolutely missing out if you haven't got that many posts, because you do not see all the forums as a newbie. You need to get your post count up. You'll see a lot more. Okay, third item on the agenda is recruiting. This is absolutely one of the mission critical areas for us. We need to recruit. The ideal is if we could have 100 people in our guild in Final Fantasy. That is the goal. In order to do that, we're going to ask you all to become recruiters. Now, how are we going to go about doing this? Well, first of all, you've probably seen myself or Dead Man putting out a blurb in the channel every so often, the channel chat that is a macro about Swarm and trying to attract people to join us. We need more people. We need more people, so we need to get you guys all recruiting. Now, what we're going to do is we'll help you with macros if you want them. You've seen what we've had already. If you want, we can start a thread with, in the private section of the forum with some possible macros that you could use and that sort of thing. But what we're going to do is we are going to reward people for every recruit they get. The recruit needs to stay long enough so they're not still a newbie, at least, all right? So they need to be with us a week, at least, minimal. Hopefully we'd like to see them soldier bee. But what we're going to do is we're going to be making some monetary awards. And those monetary awards are going to come in the form of additional money on your contracts. All right, because we can't trade and give you neat items and stuff like that like you can in other games. So we decided that instead of doing that, we will put more money on your contract when you recruit, all right? When you recruit something, and again, you're not going to receive that until they stick around for a bit. You know, they need to be here long enough to see what the swarm is like. And I'm I don't know, we kind of talked about it, whether we want to, you know, have it be, they have to be, make worker bee, or they have, soldier bees a month. All right. But we don't want people to come in and leave in 2 days. You know, we want them to stick around and get to know us. All right, so now we're also going to change, along with giving you, you know, in-game silver as part of, you know, payment for recruiting. But sorry, just a minute. We are going to change the way we handle recruiting for this short period of time. It's going to be a limited time. But for a limited time, you will be able to, if you get someone, you're talking to them, there's all kinds of ways you can do it. Group up with people. Some of you guys are already grouping up in groups with people you don't know. Some of those people may be ungilded. If they are ungilded, invite them to the swarm. You know that normally we go through a process of you put in your application, and then you wait, you get an event, and you have a full orientation, and then we invite you to join us at the newbie level. What we're going to do for this initial thing, because we want to really put a strong recruiting emphasis, we are going to make it that when you recruit somebody, you have somebody that's interested in joining the swarm, you can go ahead and give them the Ventrilo information, the same information that you were given when you first joined us. If you need that information, we'll get that to you. But you can go ahead and give them that information and invite them right into our Ventrilo. At which point, you'll be using the guest information, so that will put them in the guest lobby. And once they're in the guest lobby, that'll give you an opportunity to talk with them. It's much easier to talk with somebody, you know, by voice than it is trying to type back and forth in 1v1, one-on-one chat and stuff like that. So we'll be able to get them in here. We'll probably one of us, either, you know, myself, Dead Man, Zodson, Venom, if he's here and he's got a microphone, we'll jump in up there with you. All we're going to ask is that they get the very basics, which is, for example, they need to know about our language policy so that we don't have any, you know, blurbs coming out that shouldn't. And also, we want them to know about what kind of players we are. So we need to mention, you know, we're about respect and honor, playing honorably, not trying to exploit the game, not kill stealing, and all that kind of stuff. You know those things there that are in the laws on the first page? But primarily, you know, the things that indicate we're honorable players, so that, and if they can go along with that and they're okay with those things, we will go ahead and give them newbie rank so that they'll be able to jump down in the channel with us. All right, and they can get to know us a little bit before they finish up the application process. We only do this at the beginning of brand new chapters. All right, and Venom's nodding his head even though you can't see it. But yeah, it's only for brand new chapters do we do this. Now, so we'll be putting a time limit on it. We haven't decided on a time limit yet because we want to bring this chapter to 100 people. 100 people on our roster. So we're going to leave it open this way for a while. Now, do you guys have any questions about that at all? Anything that you want to ask? We need you guys. We need you to help us. Because we can be great PvPers, but it's also a numbers game. And a guild that has 95 people that are all level 50 or above, yeah, that's a formidable force. Yep, one person each, we'd cap immediately, that's right. Yeah, Bowman, go ahead.
Yeah, my question kind of just goes along with the recruitment. I was kind of just curious, well, how many members would we have to have before we were moved from a casual chapter to like a prime chapter or an official chapter?
Fenno, you want to answer that? Everybody watch the chat. We have an
Hellswarm.
I'm teasing event a little, teasing Venom a little bit. I typed, "No, we all want Prime." All right, Reyes, you're up.
I am here. I see everybody's icon. Where's the door?
I'll come get you.
This house actually has two doors. All right, so guys, we got a lot of stuff doing, going. We are looking for a herald. You know, this is one of those areas that is a requirement. It's not something that we can skip over. And, you know, if you feel that you are qualified, that you have the time to spend, then let me know. This is obviously a position that I'm looking for a soldier bee for. So, yeah, anybody who might be interested, feel free to PM me on the forums or like that, okay? All right. Anything else on that topic from anybody? All right. Recruit, recruit, recruit. Okay, so now, the next thing on the agenda here is that we need to talk a little bit about some vent protocol that doesn't seem to be happening all of the time. First of all, when you are in game, you are required to be in vent. Everybody knows that. I'm looking at the roster frequently and seeing there's more people in game than are in vent. If I count everybody in all the channels, y'all, everybody is not in vent, all right? When you are in game, you need to be representing Black Desert in vent, not like up in the AFK lobby or something like that. That is why that, like, when you're, you know, in the only time that you shouldn't be actively doing something, if you're actually doing something, you're fine and muted sometimes. I expect the minimal time spent in muted, because this is a community. We want everybody to be able to chat with each other and stuff, okay? So the auto AFK channel, I deliberately set it to not automatically move you to AFK, even though you're not at your computer making, you know, typing or anything, which is what normally keeps you in the vent channel. That is because of the mechanics of this game, where we have AFK fishing. And hopefully soon we'll have AFA looping. Yes, this is extremely important, Dead Man. Thank you. You need to have your family name in your comment if it is not your vent handle. It's very confusing otherwise. So everybody, fix your comment with your family name, please. Okay. Now, use of the AFK channel is for, like I said, auto fishing, nothing else at this time. And energy regen, like, you know, you're down and you went to lay in the bed in your house to regen energy, because you can't really do anything while you're, a whole lot while you're waiting for that, and we understand that. And it does take more than a half hour if you've got a lot of energy, especially if you don't have a house with a bed in it. So we understand that, all right? But if you are actively running around in the game, you best not be in the auto AFK channel. Now, it's okay, like, you, if you're fishing, because I've done this myself, I don't always sleep well at night, and I'll wake up off a night, And hey, if it's been 3 or 4 hours, I wake up, I say, hey, I think I'll run in there and see, empty my fish out, sell them, and, you know, go back and get a new rod and set myself up to fish again. That's okay. But if you're doing more than that, you shouldn't be in the auto AFK channel. If you're hunting actively and that stuff, you should not be in that AFK channel, okay? All right. Now, one of the things, too, that I wanted to call your attention to is that we've got those couple channels. We've got that one channel down there that's the Guild Missions channel, and that is for missions. Underneath that, you'll notice that we've got Velia, Heidel, and Calphian channels. Now, it says Farming Leveling Group Channel, okay? That's the place you go that if you've got a group together and you guys are working on something, you drop down into one of those channels to use it, all right? You might be just with one other person and there's only two of you, but you're working on something and you're talking back and forth about how to do things and stuff like that. That's not of general interest to everybody. And maybe you're talking a lot. And while you're talking a lot, other people in out of courtesy are not going to talk while you're trying to talk, all right, while you're trying to do this stuff. So what I would ask is if you're doing that, you're showing somebody how to find something, or you're helping somebody with some skills or whatever the case may be, or maybe just the two of you are grouped up and you're killing mobs together. That sort of stuff, please take it down into one of those other channels so people in this main channel can feel free to talk if they want to without feeling like they're going to interrupt you. All right? That's just courtesy. And those channels are not just for some special occasion. They're for you use for those kind of purposes. So feel free to do that. All right, one of the other difficulties that we've been having is that we've got people that are just over-talking other people. That is rude. Flat out, it's rude. Now, there is some of that that can happen because Vent does have a little bit of delay between when you say something into your mic and it comes out into the Vent channel. You know, we understand that. But this is not something that should keep happening and happening and happening and happening. If that's what's happening, you need to listen to yourself more and make sure that you're not interrupting other people who are already talking. Now, do we all do it occasionally? Yes, we do. I'm talking about people who kind of seem to have a habit of doing that. Let's try to stop that, please. Also, that that quiet room, the muted room down below there, right above the KBK channel, you can use that for things like you've got a headache, and you know sometimes when you've got a bad headache, just any kind of extra noise coming in is not good. I know sometimes if I'm having one of those kind of headaches, I even turn off the game sound because I really don't want to hear anything, right? The AFK channels for that. Maybe you're one of those lucky people who can play the game over your lunch hour during work, but you can't be wearing a headset, right? It's okay for that kind of stuff. What we're saying about that quiet room down below is that is not a place for you to park while you're playing, okay? Okay, so... All right, I think I had covered most of the things I meant to talk about in the vent section. Venom, Zodson, Deadman, can you think of anything else that we need to mention about vent? Okay. Okay. Okay, so you see how much we value vent. And please remember as well that vent is one of the rules of this community. It's not we're just making something up on the fly. Everybody knew you have to be in vent when you had orientation. So we expect to see you here. Okay, no more, nothing else on that. All right, Deadman, I actually think we're ready for you now in your section of this meeting.
But are they ready for me? Just kidding. All right, so with the release of this game, a lot of people came in not really understanding a lot of what was really happening with this game, and a lot of people were like, okay, yeah, let's, you know, we're gonna jump in, we're gonna grind, we're gonna get to max level, we're gonna start doing some PvP, but then everybody gets in and they're like, what? There's so much to do. And it's easy to get lost in just all the things to do in this game, whether it's crafting, fishing, gathering, all the different side quests to get a ton of energy, a ton of contribution points, explorations even, or working on getting knowledges. It's all stuff that can really take your attention away from the stronger points of the game, such as getting to those higher levels, being able to put our name out there as a force to be reckoned with, really and truly. And in order to do that, we're going to have to reach those higher levels. We need to kind of shift our focus a little bit. I don't want people to just get stagnated on spending all their time crafting and everything. We need to start getting up to those higher levels. As we get to where we're more competitive, hitting that level 45 range and everything and higher, we're going to start seeing a lot more PvP at that point. And it's okay that if you're a little bit shy of getting into that PvP, it's okay if you feel like you don't want to get there just yet. But we need to have a core group that's going to get there. And part of that's going to be getting leveling groups together, because early on in the early game, you can solo just about anything. There's literally nothing in the early game, say sub-level 20, that you can't solo. Once you're getting to, you know, 30s, you start running into groups where they're so dense you need a small group to handle them because the mobs just respawn too quickly. So we need to start working on getting leveling groups together to help people progress in levels. We need to start working on getting up to where people are in that 45, 50, and plus range. And there's a lot of reasons behind that, which brings me to my next point, the guild missions. At early levels, we can all take part in the guild missions. These are gathering missions, fishing missions, trade missions, whatever they may be. And we only need generally about 4 to 5 people to do those at a time. That does not mean we only want that many. We want everybody taking part in these guild missions. The more people we have taking part in them, the faster we get them done. If we have a mission that says go out and gather 360 birch timber, if we've got 5 people doing it, it takes about an hour to an hour and a half to do. We get about 2 hours to complete these missions. If we got, say, 15 to 20 people doing it, basically everybody in this channel right now, if they were to go out and gather birch timber, we could finish it easily in half an hour or less. We could push through those a lot faster. We can get 3 to 4 of them done in a night. And these things get us 700,000 silver to the guild coffers. That's money we can use to pay contracts. That's money to help us out later on when it comes time to purchase guild halls, because guild halls go for millions of silver. And I'm not talking about 10 million, 20 million. I'm talking hundreds of millions. I've seen them on the Korean server going for 700, 800 million. So we got to get our coffers built up. The only way we're doing that is guild missions. Now, gathering missions are great. They get us what we need early on. But the power comes in the subjugation missions, where gathering missions are specific to a guild. We get two pages to choose from. They refresh about every 10 to 15 minutes. Subjugation missions are first come, first serve for every guild on the server, with about a 10-minute reset on those, which means boss subjugations go almost immediately to those bigger guilds that are looking for them. The problem with subjugations is if you're taking those more popular ones, we also have to be ready to PvP while we're in the middle of these missions, because people are going to come and try and mess up our stuff. So we have to be ready for that. These subjugation missions are going to take anywhere from 10 to 20 people, and you have to be level 40 or higher to even take part in these, because the mobs are such high level. And like Silver Widow pointed out about getting groups together for grinding, those are going to be pretty much a necessity. We're going to have to start grouping up and doing this stuff. And like Zotson pointed out in Guild Chat, bosses do equal lots of loot. It's not just the 1.4 to, I think it's 2.5, depending on which one you take, million gold or silver that goes into the guild coffers, but they drop loot. It's not like the basic scrolls you get as you're leveling up, where you go fight Red Nose and you get nothing other than what the Black Spirit gives you. These bosses actually drop epic loot. I'm talking Uria weapons. I'm talking the, what's that other one that everybody's always talking about? Starts with an L. Yeah, I can't remember the name, but either way, some of the top end gear drops from them. There is bosses that are going to be coming out pretty soon that are world bosses that we're going to need to be level 50 plus to take on. Livertoe, thank you, Aggle. Or that's Crush, right? Yeah. There's bosses in the game that we're going to be coming across here soon that we're going to need to be level 50, 51, 52 with top-end gear. I'm talking you're rocking the best gear you can possibly get for your class, whether it be, you know, rocking the Talus armor, rocking a Jirion armor, whatever it may be, and, you know, either your Uria or Livertoe weapon or whatever is best for that particular kind of creature. And you need to be like plus 15 enchantment on them. You need to be rocking the best stones you can possibly get, because these things will one-shot you if you don't have the proper gear. I've been on the receiving end of these hits. They're not fun. So we need to be pushing for better progression in that. The best way to do it, guild missions are going to help us out in keeping the guild going, but that's what the leveling groups are going to help you out as far as going out, grinding out black stones and all that kind of stuff. I kind of got a little off topic there. I apologize for that. But in addition to the guild missions, when we're doing guild events, whether it's doing a gathering mission, a trade mission, subjugation mission, or even just doing a PvP event, we need to focus our initial attention in Ventrilo to the event. Once everybody's in their places, like we're doing a gathering mission, and we've got everybody sorted where they're at, then it's okay to start bringing in chatter, you know, like, hey, how was your day? Or, hey, do you guys know about this, that, and the other? That's fine, but let's make sure that we have our primary focus where it needs to be. Once everything's good, channel's pretty much open and free. Once again, watch the overtalk. Make sure we're not stepping on each other. Be courteous to each other. Are there any questions so far? I know I've covered a lot of information in a very quick amount of time. Dragon, you have the floor.
My question is more like I wanted to say something that is that every potion that you get, pretty much save it, and it's because I'm beginning getting to group is a low level, around level 28 or upper. There's so many mobs spawn, like Deadman's say that it will take your supply of potions out, and I'm pretty sure you will be needing them in the higher levels. That's all.
That's actually a very good point, and I don't know if anybody's been paying attention to the patch notes. This emergency patch that happened today actually put a restriction on traded items. Once you trade an item, For the items that we can, such as potions, beer, you know, basic crafting, stuff like that, the consumable types. Once it's traded to you, it becomes bound to your character and cannot be sold, cannot be traded to anybody else. And it's not family bound, so you can't even put it in your storage chest. It's bound to your character. They did that because of all the gold sellers were using traded potions in order to allow you to sell those to a vendor and make a crap ton of money on it. So, that being said, you can't be out there in the middle of a outdoor area with a ton of potions on you, and then like, well, you know, so-and-so comes up and starts helping, I trade them a bunch of potions to split it evenly, and then all of a sudden somebody else walks up, you're low, that person's still got a bunch of potions, they can't trade them to that other person. So you got to make sure you're keeping a good stockpile of your potions. One way to do that, the lower level the potion, the less it weighs. The big ones, the large potions, weigh about 2.5 LT a piece. That can really hurt your carry limits. So make sure that you're keeping a lot of the lower end potions so you can actually just process them up to the higher ones. That's a good way for that, and that was a great point, Dragon. Are there anything else so far? Okay, if there's nothing else, I'll continue on to my next topic. For those of you who haven't really taken part in any PvP games with the Swarm, there's one thing that's extremely important, and that's battle commanding. When we're in a PvP battle, there is one designated battle commander. This person is the person who's going to give out orders as to what you are to do. This means that they are guiding... they're guiding the front lines, they're guiding the strike teams that are going out and attacking from the flanks. They're also guiding the people who are sitting back and hitting with the ranged attacks. The reason behind why battle commanding is so important is it's what keeps us focused and keeps us knowing what's going on. For instance, we're out there doing a 20v20 fight out in the middle of nowhere. We got one person sitting there calling out the shots, you know, hey, take on such and such target. I need XYZ classes to roll in on it. The kind of stuff we want to hear during a battle command is if you see an enemy coming in from the left flank, don't be sitting there going, oh my God, there's a bunch of them coming from way over here. I see them over in the trees and all this. We need it clear, concise, to the point, and very small. We need troop strength. So say how many you see. Call their exact location, say 20 enemies left flank. That is as clear and precise as you can get, and it lets us know, hey, now we got a battle on possibility of two fronts. If you see a lot of casters rolling in, say, hey, casters located this point need to focus fire. You know, a little bit longer statement, but it's something that we need to hear, as opposed to, hey, we got a bunch of clothies over here, we need some people to come over and help us take them out. It doesn't really tell us where they are, it doesn't tell us numbers, it really just doesn't tell us anything. So we need it to be as clear and concise as possible. Also, when we're in the middle of combat, if you hear the phrases game faces or clear the channel, that means stop talking and listen. That means somebody has something very important that needs to be said. And to be completely honest, if we're in the middle of a PvP battle, if it doesn't have to do with the battle, please keep it to yourself or keep it to, like, guild chat or something. The vent channel needs to be used to command what's going on. Does anybody have any questions or comments on that one? Okay, so just a quick little bit about me. As many of you know, I am a military individual, so if I come across a little bit rough or gruff, just let me know. I'm sure Cal will crack the whip on me, and I'll soften up a little bit. But battle commanding is something that I've had a little bit of experience with in the past, but You know, it's something that we'll definitely find a great PvP commander for it. Go ahead, Zotsen. And that actually brings up a very good point, as I mentioned earlier, about the level 45 is where PvP actually enables. If you are below 45, no one can touch you. A lot of people are using that as a shield, essentially, so that way they don't have to worry about engaging in PvP. Sinister Swarm is founded on PvP principles. I'm not trying to use that as a way of saying you must be a PvP player to be here. But this game was kind of designed around our principles inadvertently. It's what we are, really, is we are a heavy PvP guild. Now, granted, we have gone away from that over the years. A lot of games that we play now are very casual style, Final Fantasy, Guild Wars, where you pick and choose when you want to PvP. A lot of the games where open world combat was major haven't been around for over 10 years. So this is still kind of new to a lot of newer gamers. So it's very intimidating when you see a game where you can run out just outside the gates and get killed because, you know, you're of appropriate level. To a lot of people, it's a shock. And I'm not going to say that it's going to be easy the first few times you get into a PvP battle. I foresee us losing several battles before we really start dominating over the enemies. And it's going to take practice. The only way we're going to get that practice is by actually doing PvP practice. What we're going to start doing is getting groups together of, you know, 3 to 5 members in a party and go out with another group of 3 to 5 members in a party, and we're going to duel. We're going to sit there and we're going to practice combat tactics. You know, if you're a range type, stick to your range. Stick to what is key to your class. If you are a ranger, rangers are amazing range targets. They're even better in close range because of their AoEs. You got to be careful with how you do everything. A lot of people see a sorcerer and they automatically think squishy target. They're one of the most dodgiest targets out there. Think of them more like the rogues from the early days of WoW or various other games where the rogue classes literally do not stand still. Sorcerer is just that. Wizard and Witch, they are the heavy ranged nuker class. A lot of people say they're a primary support class. They're not. They're actually the ranged nuke class. They're designed to sit there and burn down groups of enemies. Warrior, albeit it's a meat shield tank, they hit like a truck. And they have a lot of crowd control capabilities with shield bashes, ground slams, you name it. Berserker, exactly what it sounds like. They are an engine of destruction you don't want to mess with. The Valkyrie, we're high damage, high mobility, with decent tanking abilities. We have the capability to skirt around the battlefield and basically do cheap shots with our shield throws and with our celestial spears, but we can also pop into the middle of a battle, throw up a taunt, throw up a buff, throw up a heal that actually hits everybody in a certain range to help keep the playstyle balance or the battlefield balanced more or tipped more into our favor. There is so much you got to learn to do with your classes, and the only way you can do that is by actually engaging in good PvP. Part of the way we're going to do that, like I said, we're going to set up specific times for PvP practice. We're going to get out there into groups of like five, jump into the arenas that are out around the world. As of right now, I know of three specific arenas. One's next to Velia, one's just north of Heidel, and the other one is just outside Kalfion. We're going to jump in there, find a bunch of people, and we're just going to sit there and fight. That's all we're going to do. But we're going to focus on tactics. We want to try and keep our guys alive while dropping everybody else. And when we can get to where we're consistently doing that, not only is it going to put us out there as a name to where people know we're a force to be reckoned with, but it's also going to help out with recruiting, because they're going to see that we're not just all about talking a big talk. We're going to be backing that up with what we can do. There you go.
Hail Swarm.
Hail Swarm.
Hail Swarm.
Hail Swarm.
And if you are just joining us, please enter the chat channel. And if you don't already have your name attached or your family name attached to your name here in Vent, please do so at this time. I'm pretty sure like what King's Odson said about taunts not working in combat is a true statement. I'm trying to remember what the taunt is actually called for my class. Ah, there it is. Heaven's Echo. Yep, Heaven's Echo. Okay, so the taunt for the Valkyrie class doesn't really do anything in PvP for the enemy team. All it does is draws attention, hits up to five targets. But for yourself, it increases your defensive points for 60 seconds. And for your allies, it increases their accuracy for 60 seconds. Now, kind of a point on accuracy. You need high accuracy in this game. If you don't, you will not hit your target. That means you're doing less damage. If a player is higher level than you, you need a higher accuracy to hit them. So one thing you want to definitely focus on, make sure that when you get your weapons for the game, that you focus on having a weapon that as you plus it, has accuracy. If it does not have accuracy, it is useless in PvP. Primarily, you want to go towards the Levito and the Uria weapons. The reason being, they both increase AP, they both increase accuracy. They also have a third effect on them that's different between the two. Uria is bonus damage versus humans, which doesn't affect PvP at all. And then I can't remember what the Levito ones is. But the big thing is you got to focus that. You also need to make sure you don't forget to plus up your offhand. Even though your offhand may not really do much for damage, if you use a shield, it's going to increase your damage reduction. So that way when you're blocking, you can withstand attacks longer, or even when you're not, you just take less damage. When it comes to your armor, make sure you're getting stuff that is for your class. For instance, if you are a wizard or a witch, Agirian armor is useless for you. It may increase your casting speed, but that max HP isn't going to really do much for you. You need to focus on something that's actually going to help your class. It is a good idea to keep what I like to call a golf bag of equipment, meaning you have items that are going to help you both in PvP and in PvE, or for all situations. So that's just some things to think about and a little bit of food for thought on that. Like I said, I know I'm putting a lot of information out, so at this time I'd like to open up the floor for questions, comments, or any kind of concerns or anything. And it looks like, Dragon, you had a raise in there.
Yeah, I don't know. I think this one has to do more like with PvP and PvE that you were talking. You were talking about upgrading the weapons to 15 with Blackstones, and then I heard once that to get all mobs have an equal drop of the Blackstone, you just to get even better, you just have to invest in nodes, right?
This is correct. He brings up a great point. When you are looking at a node on the map. So if everybody would just go ahead and open their map, you'll be able to see this. So let's say we're looking at Northern Guard Camp, or one of the nodes that you have points invested into. when you are looking at those nodes or even just a city, you'll see this button up at the top left that says invest energy negative 10. You can invest energy into any node in the game by, as long as you have contribution invested into it, and it costs 10 energy per investment. Now, as you increase the amount of energy you dump into a node, it gains more levels. The higher the level, the higher the drop rate in that area. In the cities, it's a little different. It has to do with how your workers actually produce materials and all that kind of stuff. But out in the open fields, it's how you get better drop rates on your items, whether it be blackstones or, you know, higher rarity items. That's basically what it's doing. It increases the drop rate of the higher rarities. And with the blackstones, yes, they have an equal drop rate across the board, does not matter the creature. However, you generally will not see one drop before level 20. Reason being is you really don't have a lot of your good in-game gear until about level 20. So right about then, you'll start seeing the drops. After 30, you're going to see your drops go even more. Resetting knowledge is also a way to increase your drop rates from specific mobs, because as you learn more about the mobs, they're easier to kill. You grind through them quicker. They don't necessarily always give you the same kind of drop rates. If you go to Calpheon, there's a library there that you can actually reset your knowledge on certain creatures. And that helps you out with getting more energy, getting more, basically better loot overall. I will do what I can on that front, Silver Widow. As a lot of you guys do know, I make a lot of videos on stuff. I'm working on getting some more, specifically whether it's tutorial type stuff or just to show you some of the really cool stuff. So I'll work on getting some more videos posted up here pretty soon, Silver Widow. And King Zotson, you got a racer? Excellent. So I'll start forwarding all my videos through him. Oh, that was actually perfect. That's some great information that a lot of people may not have been aware of. To kind of piggyback on that, with when it comes to a lot of our public media, we got to be careful with what we post. You got to really, really know how to go about a subject to where you're not breaking any of the swarm laws. So when you are putting those videos together, like you said, get with him. He will help you with what you need to know in order to actually make some good videos that, you know, are swarm worthy. Anybody else? All right, let's see. Post maps and picks for like farming. Oh, actually one of the best places you can go is BD Foundry, Black Desert Foundry. You can either Google search it, or I believe we have a link to it directly in our forums, which if you're not yet a worker bee, you may not be able to see that information. BD Tome. Oh. Oh, posting maps and pics. Okay, so if you're posting, maps, pictures, stuff that's got like our secret farming locations, make sure those go into the PVE section of our Black Desert forums. There is a thread that Clea has made. It actually states at the top of it, you know, like BDO picks and stuff like that. Make sure you post in there. That way we can keep everything consolidated, and it also stays into the members only sections, so that way any Joe Schmo that jumps on our forums can't see it. And Raz, you had a race, sir.
Yes, I did. As a lot of people know, I like streaming. My computer I currently have is less than savory for that. Deadman's actually been helping me a lot with it, but as soon as I do get the new tower, I will be streaming probably from the point that I wake up to the point that I go to bed. And my stream channel does, I mean, rule number one, no swearing. I don't want that on my streams. Even if I wasn't a Swarm member, I would have that rule. Yes, on Twitch. Anybody who wants to follow me before I get to that point, I'll be happy to link you my Twitch page.
Awesome. Good bit of information on that. And in addition to Ryaz being a streamer, I also stream. I do have a thread with my stream link in it and everything. And I will be posting, you know, in my comment or on the shout box, usually both, when I'm actually streaming. So if anybody wants to view what I'm doing and all that kind of stuff, it's always going to be up there. But I do try to keep that channel private, so do not give it out to somebody who's not a part of the Swarm. Okay, Dragon, you have another race?
Yeah. I'm so sorry for so many raids, but I had a question, or more of an idea. Since we're doing groupings, and I'm pretty sure that many of us work and enter different hours, I was thinking of using the forums to create groups of different times for, or like, people to put their time to make groups, as well a forum for those who live streams, so we can know who live streams and stuff like that for the guild. Yeah, for the
The only thing I have to say about the about putting together preformed groups is we want to try and stay away from the idea of setting up static groups. It's good to get with people that are on around the same time, but let's stay away from the static group ideas due to the fact that they do have a tendency to create cliques, and we do not want those. We want everybody to want to be able to group up with everybody. So it's nice having those times so we know who's available around those times. But let's try to stay away from the static idea, though. In addition, with the streaming, if you guys want to piggyback in on my streaming thread, by all means, go ahead and put up your stream links in there. Or we can create a separate thread for it. Either way works. So really, really good ideas there, Dragon. All right, we got time for a few more questions. Anybody else? Remember, this time is all about getting information to you guys. So if there's anything you need to know, now's the time to ask. Go ahead, Raz.
Builds, as you know, like previous games, I know you know, saying what's a good wizard build really doesn't pertain to this game too much, but I often like to refer to websites for recommended combos, you know, stuff, you know, just general information about your character to help improve that. Do we have a section on the forums or otherwise that will list some websites like that? Because I know I've got a BDO database hotkeyed for like the crafting stuff, but it doesn't cover truthfully, it doesn't cover everything that I've been looking for. I've been mostly on my warrior because, you know, to me it's a little bit easier to play, but I want to work on my wizard.
We don't currently have a thread for that, just due to like what you said. There's not a lot of things of, oh, you pretty much need to do this with your class at all times in order to succeed, because this game's all about your playstyle. What works for one person may not work for you. For instance, I know there's a combo that one person recommended to me with the Valkyrie. It's using the spinning shield throw, follow up with the celestial spear, and then throw another spinning shield throw. I find that combo works great for finishing large groups of mobs, but I've heard people use that ridiculously large amounts of time as like an easy mode farming. The only problem is if you're farming against creatures that aren't affected by crowd control, that combo is useless because its sole purpose is to lock them into a small group and burn them down. So you got to really kind of play around with what works best for you. Now, I do plan on doing some videos myself here pretty soon on guides on how to play certain classes, doing certain things with them. And I'll link those up once they're up there. But for now, if you find some good guides that you want to post, please use the PvE section of our forums for that. And we'll get a thread started on that, so that way people can post their guides and we can actually just create a separate one for each class. And that'll make it to where everything's easier and more focused as to what goes in there. And if need be, we can create some sections of the forums in there. We'll have to get with King Zood for that and get that all squared away. But we can definitely work on that idea. So that was actually a really, really good idea. As far as information links for Black Desert, we do have some sections already set up for those. Bringing up that particular thread real quick. In the Black Desert PvE section, there is a thread stickied at the top called BDO Guides, Videos, and Links. Feel free to drop a post in there that actually has that information. Also in the Swarm section, the BDO or Black Desert Swarm section, there is a post that I put in there called Tips and Tricks You Have Found. This is going to get stickied here pretty soon to the top, so it's always available and easy to see. Any kind of tricks you guys find, like the video that I made of how to tame a horse, guaranteed you will catch it every single time type video. That kind of stuff is the stuff we're looking for in there. Stuff that's not, you know, readily available by a quick search on Google. If you find like a secret cave that always has a chest to find, that's always a good thing to post up, because not everybody knows about stuff like that. So they're always really good bits of information for us to share with each other. And Kalia, you have the floor.
All right. These types of things are the very reason that we have one public channel, one public forum, and all of the others are restricted to Swarm members. We don't want our members going out and ferreting out all kinds of good information for our members and then have it wind up in a public forum that anyone that happens to be dropping by can take and share with everybody else. All right? Let them do their own hunting. All right. So, let's make sure. That's why I put that shush thread in the forums. There's a number of you that have not signed that yet. I would like you to get to that thread, read it, and sign, please. This is partly to for you to really realize what's public and what isn't, and that we don't want to share information that our members have found with every Joe Schmo that drives by. Okay, let's keep it for our own use. And that's not to say that other people can't find it. Just as we were hearing, some things are harder to find than others. So, yeah, we'll just share it with each other. Go ahead.
Awesome. Thank you for that. And that goes to say, obviously, if you find something that you just can't find, like if you searched high and low on Google, you've gone to the end of the internet, you can't find it, but it's information you found yourself in the game, put it in our member-only forums. There's also been several posts coming up about the Black Desert Bible. We have a post about that already in the swarm section. There's also a link to it in the PVE section of the forums. So just to kind of alleviate multiple posts, we're going to consolidate a lot of these posts down into one post. So if you wind up seeing your post missing one day, that means it's probably already been posted and we've just consolidated it down. It's not that we're trying to say, hey, we don't want to listen to what you got to say. It's because that information is already out there. If you can't see our member-only forums, well, hey, here's some incentive to get on there. Get that post count up, and then you'll be able to see all the stuff that a lot of us have already posted. That's why for your first 10 posts, it's a really great idea not to create new threads, because you never know when you might be doubling up posts that are already there. Just get in and make comments on the other posts that are already there. Once you have your 10, you'll be able to see what we're talking about. Oh, and that tips and tricks post is sticky now, so you guys will be able to see it at the top. And I think that's pretty much all I've got to cover. Am I missing anything, Cal Zotson?
Yeah, and I'm sure that, you know, we're going to have other things that are going to come along. And in that regard, you guys should feel free. If you have a topic that you think we need to discuss, feel free to let one of us, you know, myself or Dead Man or Zotson, Venom 2, he's pretty busy, but let us know so we can put it on the agenda. All right? We may not hit it all.
As I mentioned at the start of my little speech, there's so much information in this game and so much you got to know. You know, it's hard to keep track of everything. So feel free to always put input on stuff that needs to come up in the meetings and whatnot. Silver Widow, go ahead. And Silver typed, can the guild overall look at guild chat more so people without mics not get ignored? That's actually a good point. We do have members of the swarm who either don't have mics or can't speak. We actually do have a couple members in the community who are mute. And I don't mean they keep their mic on mute. I mean they literally cannot speak. So make sure that you keep your guild chat in a separate window so you can always see what's going on. But to also touch on that subject, if you type something and somebody doesn't immediately respond, another good way to get a hold of them is through PMing in Ventrilo. Very simple, very easy to do. And if people got their WAV files turned on so they can hear when people send them PMs, they'll get a little ding that says, hey, you got a PM. So use that as another method if somebody seems to be ignoring you. It could be they could be doing something else, such as those of us who have kids or those of us who are constantly moving back and forth between website and game or don't have, you know, two monitors and all that kind of stuff. Always be aware that someone may have something going on that prevents them from seeing what's going on. But at the same time, let's be courteous to those who can't speak and keep our eyes towards the guild chat more often. Yes, you can, actually. If you hover over your chat window, and I want everybody to do this so they see what I'm talking about, you'll see a plus sign next to the chat tab. If you hit that, it allows you to create a new chat tab. This allows you to assign what channels actually show up in it, the transparency of the window, and you can even change the name of it, like under where it says view chat and all that. No, you can't change your name, sorry. Anywho, so once you do that and you hit OK, Enter, now you click on, say this one for me would be Chat Tab 3. So now when I click on that one, I have a couple of different buttons at the top on the tab. The left one is a cog. That allows you to go in and adjust the settings for what you can see in the channel. The one on the right looks like two windows, like you're popping one out of the other. If you click that, it actually separates the window out. Now, from there, to move the to move that tab around, you can't just grab the tab and try to drag it. It won't move. You actually have to hit Escape to bring up your menu. And on the fourth row down, third button over, you have a button called Edit UI. You click that, you'll see that chat window is kind of gray looking. You can grab it and move it wherever you want it. Once you place it, don't just exit out of this window. Once you move it to where you want it, you have to hit the Save button to keep it where it's at. And if at any time you want to collapse that back into the main window, there's another button on there that is a box with an arrow pointing down. You hit that, it rejoins it to the main chat window. And Silverwood had a question of, is there a way to make guild chat in-game ding or something when someone talks in-game? As of right now, no. I believe they did add something to where it dings now whenever you send somebody a whisper. But there is no way for guild chat on that one as of yet. That would actually be a great thing to actually send to the developers as a suggestion. If you go to the official forums, there's actually a suggestions thread in there where you can actually put in ideas like that. And they've been really good at listening to the players lately. If enough people are suggesting that as an idea, we might just get it pretty soon. I agree, and CM Jelska has also been very good about just responding to a lot of the issues on the forums as well. That actually kind of brings up another, and any info on where to find bounties. I haven't found it myself. Has anybody else found that yet?
Yeah. You know, I talked to a dark man or something, and he was a way to find people. I don't know if that may be related to bounties, but you had to be higher level.
From what I understand, that one is exclusively for finding somebody. Like, if you know a player's name, you can actually use that to find their general location, like if you're hunting someone. Such as if we wanted to find the leader of, say, Gravity, since they were PKing us there for a little bit. You just go to that guy, you pay him, I think it's in energy, might be in silver, I can't remember. And he actually pinpoints that person with a beacon on your map. And an auto path to it as well. And for those of you who don't know, this guy is in Velia in the tavern.
Now, is that feature, is that something that just pings their location at the moment you request it? Or does that ping stay on that player until you find them?
Pings at the moment you request it, so it gives you a general area of where to look. Now, if they're close to where you're at, good chance you'll find them quicker. You could also use it as a way to find their general area if you got people over near it. You then turn around and ping it as a guild ping, which is control left click or control double left click, and it helps you finding stuff. And so where it'll put in, we'll see if I can find more info on the bounty hunting thing. It'll also help with bounties, because one of the things about bounties is they haven't given all the details on it, but basically if a player is PKing, you can go and set a bounty on them. We don't know if that bounty is going to be giving you back karma or if you're going to get money out of it. But the bounty system is basically going to be a way to go out and hunt people and actually do good for the community. And by that, I mean the gaming community. And using that particular individual in Velia is a good way to help you find those bounty targets. Oh, trust me, they are on the hunt list. For those of you who don't know, Gravity declared on us a couple days ago, and they held their declaration on us for about 4 to 6 hours, which was, they basically paid extra money to keep a war on us so they could PK two of our members continuously with no penalty. Because of that, they are permanently on the kill on site list. If you see them, you're able to take them out, by all means, drop them. Call in as many people as you have to as well. Which kind of brings us into another topic that I'll let, KOS, kill on site, whatever you guys want to call it. Yes, we can kill without declaring, but if we kill without declaring, you take karma penalty for that. So we got to also be careful with that. Silver Widow, you have another raise? And while Silver Widow's typing out their question, I'll answer Woods. We have ally guilds, yes, Tenacious. We are working on a list of others. As soon as we have more, Clea and I will get a list together and put it on the forums for you guys. All right, Silver Widow's question is, who's going to build siege items like cannons and such? Excellent question. There is siege workshops already in the game. Anybody can build them. It is highly recommended that everybody build them. We can get ammo for the cannons and such from the guild store, which I believe anybody can purchase those, but it uses guild funds. So we need to make sure that we allot people how much they're allowed to spend to buy them, and we'll have to monitor that, of course. And as I mentioned with the PvP, everybody needs to be ready to PvP. There's reasons behind that. One of those is alliances. If we're, say, shying away from PvP, but we have an alliance with a heavy PvP guild, and they get into a war, and they want us to back them up, you know, without fail, we have to be able to back them up, because if we're not backing up our allies, we're going to lose them. I don't think we'll lose Tenacious that way, but obviously if we're not backing them up, we're not holding our own, they're not going to be as willing to help us. Let's see. Bacon, you had a raise?
It's just a quick idea on this guild that was griefing us. Why don't we do a griefing party where we only go after their guild leader for like 4 hours, you know, to pay him back properly?
Well, there's actually a few reasons why we don't do griefing parties. One, we're not griefers. We will actively PvP. If we have a guild on KOS list, when we go after them, it's not griefing at that point. If they are on kill on site, we're actively hunting them. We're going to declare on them, and we're going to go after their leader. And we are going to drop them repeatedly. We're going to go after every one of their members and drop them repeatedly. when we take on a war against somebody, we're not doing it just so we can, you know, have a little fun and you know, knock them around a little bit. We're going out there to assert to people that we have the power to back up what we say. Guilds like Gravity that are bullies, we're going to be taking the fight to them, not just letting them come around and push us around. That's done. They come at us again, not only are we going to declare back, so long as we have the strength to do so, Tenacious is going to declare on them as well. And vice versa, if Tenacious declares on somebody, we're going to back up Tenacious. So we need people leveling, as I mentioned earlier, so we can start doing that. This means gear, levels, everything. Because if you're even one level below somebody, your accuracy needs to be much higher to be able to hit that person. So starting tomorrow, we're putting together leveling groups. If you're not in a leveling group and you're in game and you're just messing around, please get into a leveling group. We need to get people higher level. You level much faster in a group than you do by yourself. If this means you get a little behind on gathering some knowledge, you know, we're going to have to make some sacrifices here and now so we can be more competitive. If we want to be able to hold territory, we need to be competitive. And holding territory is key to a successful guild in this game. As Dotson said, we need more power. All right. And after that, let's go ahead and go with Crush. You get a raise.
Yeah, I just want to go back to the karma system. So when you guys hit 50, you'll be able to flag PvP with Control C. It's something to be cautious of because once you hit negative 300,000, you're going to go negative, and that's when you can start dropping items and gear and items break. And when you have high-end gear, that's when you start wasting millions of silver. So you guys are going to want to be careful as well. So the way it works is once you flag and you hit someone, you lose 10,000 karma. And if you kill, you lose 200,000. So killing two people after you flag, you're eligible on death to start losing items or items breaking. And yeah, that's pretty much why. It's just more of advice more than a question.
Very good advice. Yeah, as you mentioned, there's a lot of guides out there on what happens when you go perma-red. A lot of these guides have some information that's not 100% confirmed. From the notes I've seen from the Russian server, the Japanese server, which actually do a lot more PvP than the Korean server does, there is a penalty for when you drop red. You do drop items. Your gear can break. Like, I don't mean just, oh, it hits zero durability, it's useless, it doesn't have stats. No, it goes away. It literally shatters and you have to replace it. This is one of the reasons once we start seeing reds out there that are of enemy guilds like Gravity, we're going to go after them full force. ManUp is a huge PK guild. They've been around since the days of Terra. We see them, we're not friends with them by any means. They're there purely for our pleasure of killing if they're red. It sounds kind of bad for me to say that, but really and truly, we have a red equals dead policy in the community. It's in the policy section of our forums. If you don't believe me, go check it out. It's actually a pretty good read in there. There's a lot of really good information on our policies on PvP in there. You see reds, you don't even have to ask our permission. If they're red, go drop them. Have fun. If you don't want to mess with them, by all means, don't. And if a red flag player attacks you, you do not lose karma if you turn around and kill them. But if you kill somebody who's not flagged, you do take karma penalty. Good point on that, Crush. Right, Kalia mentioned we need guild funds to declare on anyone. Okay, for those of you who don't know how the PvP system works for GVG, guild versus guild combat is done this way. The guild master declares. That declaration costs us 1 million silver. For every 2 hours that we go with the other guild not declaring back on us, we have to pay another 300,000. If they declare back on us, there is no additional fee. And the war ends once it basically comes to a close, meaning one guild withdraws from the other or whatever. As the GVG goes on, only players 45 and higher can participate. You don't need a flag at this point. You're automatically going to be red to them. They're automatically going to be red to you. There is no karma penalty either. You can kill a GVG target without any kind of penalty. The big things to worry about during that is if you die, you don't lose any XP, but any gems socket into your gear can and most likely will break. Good idea, keep a good stock of gems. What I mean when I say gems is those little black crystals that you get from just random farming and quests. For instance, I think I have one or two on me right now. Scratch that, I do not, but I do have some socketed. For instance, I have a magic crystal of abundance armor in my Agerian armor. Gives damage reduction plus one. Can break whenever I take or whenever I die. So you want to keep a couple of extra spares of those sitting around. Also, if you die in a PvP battle, do not release right away. Everyone needs to start carrying these little emergency kits that you can buy from various vendors. Any potion vendor sells them. They have a 5-minute cooldown, but they allow you to resurrect a dead player. What this allows you to do is somebody dies, enemy runs away from them, whatever. You walk over to that person, resurrect them, they're back in the fight. That's a lot faster than them having to run back from a node or a city. Thank you, Kalia, for the link on that. Emergency medical kit. That's actually a good question. Silver Widow types, so can't kill someone that just looks funny. Actually, if they're red, by all means, go for it. But I'll once again stress, we are not a PK guild, we are not a griefing guild, so don't just run up to somebody and say, I don't really like your face, you're dead. Even though it can be funny. Okay, at this time, I think I've given myself enough cotton mouth. I'm going to turn the floor back over to Kalia.
All righty, and thank you, Deadman. All right, we are coming to the end of this meeting, and some of you are probably sitting there thinking it's about time, but I'm going to talk about money. As you all know, we've asked you not to collect your payments to the, you know, that you could be collecting from the guild funds. It's a minimal amount at this point in time, but we've asked you not to do that because we were trying to build up some funds. At this point, you can go ahead and start collecting your money from the guild fund. Now, here's the deal. We can only pay as long as there's money in the guild fund. Most of that comes from missions. Some of it comes from our regular activities that we're all going and doing throughout the day as we're playing. But a huge majority of that comes from those missions. So, we need everybody helping on these missions. I have noticed that we have a mission, and we may get, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 down in the mission channel helping with the mission, and we've got 4 or 5 or 6 up in the other channel doing whatever they're doing and gonna ignoring that we're doing missions. This is not a good plan. And so because we need that, and we need to build, not only do that, but we need to pay you, but also to build up so we can declare war on other people and all the things that Deadman has talked about before. We want to start trying to do, if possible, 5 missions a day. I would really like us to do at least 3. I would hope that we're going to be able to get set so that we can maybe run one, at least one of those during the daytime, when it's better for some of the people in the guild versus having all of them at night. So we'll maybe, if we can do it, spread them out a little bit. But we need you participating. The other night we did, was that last night? Yeah, we had one that was collect logs. We had 2 hours to do it. We finished it right at an hour with like 7 or 8 people helping. How fast could we do that if instead of that we had 20 people? All right? So we are going to expect that every one of you is going to participate in at least 2 a day. Now, I know that means giving up some of your playtime that you could be doing other things. But if we don't do that, we are not going to be able to declare wars on people. We're not going to be able to pay your contracts, etc. You all get that. One thing I will mention for some of you that were participants in the fishing missions, the couple that we have tried to do, and they were both didn't turn out well. For now, anyway, if we happen to come up with a fishing mission, we are going to ignore it. We aren't going to do it. We're just going to, you know, drop it, basically, and we'll spend that hour or whatever, maybe in a leveling group or something. I'll have to look at how, if we can just abandon it and immediately start another one. But we're not going to do it because it's wasting our time to try to keep fishing for fish we're not going to get enough of. It's silly. So we're not going to do that. We're not going to waste your time like that anymore. Now, as far as contracts are concerned, you're going to find out that the amount that you're going to be getting in your contracts is going to start changing. People who are actively participating in the guild missions and stuff, which we've already said we need, you are going to find out that your paycheck is a little higher than the people who are not participating. You know, we're not paying great huge sums of money or anything like that, so maybe people, you know, aren't going to care about it. But you know what? If you don't want to be part of this team, and you want to try to solo everything or group up with strangers, kind of makes one wonder. So don't be surprised if your paychecks there start looking different than other people's. That difference is going to start showing up in a week or so on the contracts. Does anybody have any questions about that? I guess what I'm saying is these guild missions are like part of an obligation that you have to this guild, because for one thing, we're going to be paying you contract money that you can collect every single day that you log on. And additionally, if we aren't doing these things, we're not going to be able to play half the game. So, you know, I'm just letting you know that we're going to be expecting your participation in these missions. Even though you might rather be out there PvPing or fishing or whatever. Okay, so at this time, I think we've pretty much covered everything. Okay, yeah, so there's a 10-minute cooldown between missions, which is not anything. And there's no penalty for dropping, but I believe that's going to count as one of our 5 for the day, and we really don't care. It's pointless to try to do some of those with those fish. We just haven't got fishing skill high enough, nor do we know where they are. So, okay, let me see. Dragon, you have a raise?
Yes. I just remembered that I did have a question that I totally forgot at the beginning. You guys were talking that when recruiting, there was a macro, but I don't know how to access the macro. Can you give like a swift explanation or answer to that, please?
All right. If you hit, you know, if you just hit enter, so you get the bar up where you can do guild chat.
Uh-huh.
And you've got the little tabs over there on the side, party, whisper, general. Oh, I forgot what else is there. Channel, I think. Over on the right, you've got M and S. M is macros. So if you click on the M button, it'll list slots where you can put macros in.
Oh, thank you.
You can tell where you want it to go. Like for our recruiting macros, I have it on channel. You just keep clicking it till channel shows up. And then you have to be sure that you use the escape key, because that's actually what saves your macro. Otherwise, it can disappear if you close that chat bar. Without saving it, your macro won't be there when you try to use it. Be sure you hit X escape before you do anything else once you finish up your Mac. All right. So I believe, unless I forgot something, Venom, Zodson, Deadman, have I forgotten anything? Have any of us forgotten anything we intended to say tonight? Yeah, Reyes, if we get to the point where we know where some of those fish are and stuff, and people with the skill to do them, yeah, we'll add them back in. But right now, they're just a waste of time for us. But anyway, anybody? Anything? Well, among the officers, that is, at least right now. All right. Dead man? Venom? Okay. We have one last thing that we need to do. And that one thing is we actually have a promotion tonight. Advancing from newbie to worker bee this evening is Lilliams. Congrats and hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Woot.
Hail swarm.
All right, and for the rest of the newbies, it's a pretty much post count, I think. But I really, 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 really encourage you to get your post counts up, because you guys are missing out on 3/4 of the stuff that's getting posted about PvP and all that kind of stuff. Well, there's nothing PvP yet. There will be. But the PvE stuff and the general discussion, you guys are missing out on all that. So once you get your post count up, you'll be able to get that and then see that. So. And I'll fix your rank and that stuff, Lilliams, after the meeting. Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Now, the last thing that this has run a long time. We had so much to do tonight. But if anybody has a pressing question that they want to ask, now is the time to do it. Please use a raise. If it's something that can wait till our next meeting next Friday night, that would be better since we've gone so long with this meeting already. But if you have something you really need to ask in this meeting, please put a raise in chat. Thanks, Deadman. All right then. Going once, going twice, meeting adjourned. Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Oh, come on, come on, come on. Louder, louder, more people. I'm gonna have you
hail
do it again.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm.
Hail swarm. We need a hail swarm practice
hail
session. Swarm. Thanks everybody. All right,
I heard
now.
Gold.
Oh yeah, let's get. Can we get everybody? Where do we? Should we put them along the over by the couches, so we can get a guild
yeah.
picture? Guild.
Yeah, my game just crashed. I have to load back in.
We'll wait for you. Where's everyone at?
Else, let's get down. Okay, you could. I think you probably could be up.
We are in 9-3 in Heidel, which is my house.
I'm away. I just came out of the game.
a few minutes ago.
Yeah, I got to relaunch your into. Give me a minute.
I'm on my.
Alright, I'm gonna do a bio really quick while it's loading.
Laying on the turkey is not permitted. Sad.
What?
Be good. Maybe we could get Deadman to move his table somewhere so it's not like, you know, turkey face time or something. Okay,
yeah, I'll take care of that.
You guys that have the signs up, could you take them down for now, just for the picture? And also, let's see. I have not messed with the screenshot functions on this. Has anybody else done so that might want to take the screenshot?
Okay.
Wait for me. I'm running.
Okay. We're waiting.
Should we take off the names?
I'm gonna be fixing that. Cause I'm not gonna take it with any names present. I'm gonna do Control U to hide the UI entirely. I'm just fixing stuff in the house to hide a few things. Logo.
Yeah, we need names. At least take a couple with names and then without. And like I said, if you've got one of those little banner things up, you know, that's awesome seeing Hail Swarm. As long as it's not blocking somebody else, you could probably do that. Leave those, I guess. I should have said we shouldn't, but oh.
How do you re-enable the UI?
Control U again.
Oh, there. I got a. Wasn't responding before, that was weird. Gotta hold control first for a second.
Where did you guys say you're at?
Heidel 9-3, my house.
Look for the giant red beam of light. I see you running around outside. I see somebody. Terrius, right?
That's me.
I don't know where you're at.
See,
I'm on my way, slowly but surely.
I don't know, something in this room gives a standard for something. We're always brushing our shoulders. Check on that next time, please, Deadman.
This is Sotica.
I think it's you, man. You did it.
I think we should take the picture, but without sitting down, just. So there are some that are kneeling and the other ones are like standing up.
open mic.
I can't find the house.
Heblian, you have an open mic.
Oh, Terrius, where you going? Ran right by it.
I have a what?
Your mic was open. Do you have a vent running in admin, Heblian?
Is it off now? Sorry. No, I don't. I just right click it, right? And just hit run as admin.
Yeah, or you can go into the properties, go to compatibility, and set it to always run admin. Because if you don't have it in admin, it can get frozen open like that. And if you're in game, it won't let you talk. Pretty much. Anybody still on their way?
Yes, I'm trying to get to you guys, but
okay.
Just gotta give me a minute.
That's okay.
When I have on this uniform, any reason why my guild name turns white and my cooking expert turns...
When you are wearing the ghillie suit, your name is hidden from anybody not on your friends or guild member lists.
Oh.
What is a ghillie suit? Sidere has connected.
That's the green thing I'm wearing.
Oh, yeah, the ghillie suit. Basically, one thing I forgot to mention, one of the things we have is the strikers with the guild. And we'll cover this more once we actually get this all going. All the striker team members will have to have those because it makes it to where you can't be identified.
Oh, so we will have that? Okay, let me back
How up. Lovely, how lovely in PvP not to be unidentifiable.
Basically, it makes it to where people can't say, oh, well, it was that guild that did it. Nope, you don't know who did it.
However, that is a cash shop item. They are currently on sale. So if you are someone who is interested in people not being able to identify you in PvP, you can decide for yourself whether you want to, get one in the cash shop or not. They are not cheap. On the other hand, they also give you a plus to gathering, as well as that invisibility of identification factor. However, for that invisibility thing to work, you must have all five pieces of the suit on.
Four.
So, for example, four, whichever. For example,